I'm Tom Doggett. I'm a backend web developer at Unicity International, a local franchise organization, a multi-level marketing company in Orem. And today I'm going to go over a bit of Git-Flow. Just to start off, anyone here not familiar with Git? Because I'm not really. Oh, no, I'm sorry. Too late to rephrase that in a better way. Not really going to cover the principles of Git too much. I'll just jump in. I'm sorry. never mind. Come on. There we go. So, to start off with, if you've been developing as long as most of us, we have the olden days of source control. And if anyone here isn't using some form of source control, you probably should. I'd recommend Git. It's what I like the most. But, you know, we have the olden days of Subversion. Anyone here ever use Subversion? That's a safe question to ask. One of the things that I really liked about Subversion was that it was very orderly. It was very it was a pain to get set up in terms of the branching and that sort of stuff, but at least you had a very standardized way of approaching things that you could expect with pretty much everybody's repository. But nowadays we have the brave new world of distributed source control, which I'll be honest, I've never actually seen anything as complicated as this, but this particular model is entirely possible with people being able to commit to push and pull code back and forth from each other from a centralized repository that you set up. In fact, you know, a lot of us probably use GitHub as a central repository, but when it comes to Git, that's really kind of an artificial construct, the idea of having a centralized server. There's all sorts of stuff that's possible. And for those of us who have been using Git with large teams, maybe teams that are spread over various offices or even various states or countries, we can recognize that we actually do run into situations like this sometimes. There's more control that we need to have. And so, one of the solutions is, one of the solutions is Git-Flow, which is, it may look just as complicated, but we'll go into it. It's actually quite orderly. It's a great way to approach some of these situations. In fact, if you've been using Git for a while, and if you've been dealing with the issues of multiple development teams, multiple developers working on the same thing, you might find that you've actually already got a lot of the structure down anyways. A lot of this just kind of naturally flows out of the way things worked before and kind of finding the way things work well now. But a couple things to note before we start off. Git-Flow is actually not software. It's a methodology. And much like methodologies and ways of doing things that are kind of really popular right now, like Scrum and Agile and that sort of thing, it's a simple solution that is meant to be applied towards complex problems. And that kind of like with Agile and Scrum, that kind of means that if you're technically following it by the book, you're kind of following it wrong. Because with most of these things, the real world isn't really that simple. And the real world will obviously require, you know, finding out what works for you and pushing things and pulling things back a little bit. So one of the things I do want to talk about, I'll be going over kind of the basic idea of what the Git-Flow model is. But at the end, one of the things I do want to talk about is some of the shortcomings. And that's something I found that with a lot of the presentations online, a lot of the blog things online, people don't really go into too much is where Git-Flow can help. I mean, they do go into where Git-Flow can help, but they don't really get into too much of where Git-Flow maybe, it only goes so far. Because it deals with really kind of more of a hypothetical model, and all of us have to deal with the crazy complexities of what the real world has to deal with. So I do want to get into that in a bit. But to start off with, there are really only two basics of the way Git-Flow works. As opposed to the way when we usually find Git-Flow, as I'll get into here in a bit, instead of having one main branch, we have two main branches. So just keep that in mind. There are two main branches with Git-Flow. And then everything else that you saw in there are other temporary branches that we kind of bring into existence as we need them and drop them away when we're done. But otherwise, that's it right there. Two branches and temporary branches that just kind of, they're like quantum branches. They're Schrodinger's branches. They exist kind of when you want them to and when not. So to start off with, if we go back kind of in time and we kind of approach the subversion model that maybe some of us worked with, if you want it, and this is an oversimplification and that sort of thing, but I just want to kind of approach it from this idea here of how the code could be looked at. Where when we use subversion, we had the centralized repository, and the idea would be that if anybody were to check out from the repository, they would get code that would hopefully, it would be older, because nobody's technically hopefully working on it at the time. It would be older code, but it would be stable code. Fingers crossed. That may not have actually been the case, but you know, that's kind of the hope. And everybody who's doing their development on their machines, until they check their code back in, their code is obviously newer because they're working on it, but you couldn't depend on it to be stable. So keeping in mind this idea of the stable code and kind of the age of the code, you have that kind of separation. And then when each of us discovered Git for the first time, probably we imitated this particular style. I'm just guessing. I did. That might just be because I'm kind of silly. But, you know, I would make a remote master, and in my case, I found GitHub, and I'm like, oh, that's awesome. A place to kind of shove my code that I can share between everything. And so I kind of treated it in the same way that I did Subversion. GitHub would have the older but stabler code, and my development machines would have the unstable but newer code. And then we would This is entirely the way I went. If you already knew about branches and kind of the way that you know, Git handles branches beforehand, you're awesome, and I envy you because it took me a while to figure out that it actually had that. But when I discovered branches, that meant that I could, when I was working with other people, I could split my code off, work on whatever features I wanted to, without having to worry about stepping on other people's toes. And what that meant is I kind of split that stable, unstable, newer type thing into kind of three areas where my code that I was working on, it was the newest code possible, but it was definitely unstable until I merged it back in. The master branch of the repository, that became stable code and newer code. And GitHub, where we would finally push everything when we were done, that would be the stable code and the older code. So if we kind of take those ideas, we kind of look at the two main branches of GitHub, they kind of adopt this idea of both of them should be holding stable code, but this branch holds the newer code, and this branch holds the older code. And this is also the one issue of the naming convention that might be a little, you'll just have to get it into your head. If you want to use GitHub, you'll probably just have to get this in your head. This one's called master, and this one's called develop. Now, if you're used to using Git, the main branch is called master. That would be this one. And that's why it's a little confusing at first. So if you want to go through some sort of transition period in your head, you might want to think that, okay, the develop branch, that's what I'm used to as master. And the master branch, you could call that production, the production branch, that sort of thing. Again, getting down to this idea of really what the branches are supposed to handle, the age of the code, and remember that both of them are really supposed to be stable because we, you know, like I was saying with the finding the branches, we can branch off the unstable code into their own kind of separate area of existence. So everyone cool? We got develop and we have master, and everyone kind of cool with kind of what they're both meant to handle? Because that's probably the most confusing thing. Just the naming convention. So like I said, there's two things to keep track of with Git-Flow. Is they have two main branches, and then they have the other branches that exist as you need them. And those branches go in these different areas. Feature branches, release branches, and hotfixes. And I'll be going through an example later on. So I'll be covering all this kind of twice. So if anyone does have a question, though, always feel free to raise it. I'm going a little bit faster than I kind of meant to because I'm kind of nervous. So if anyone has a question or a comment, feel free to just bring it up. So starting with the other branches, we have the feature branches. So if we're developing and we have something that we want to work on, we establish a feature branch for each of those particular things. We pull the code by branching off of develop, not off of master. Master stays by itself. We work on the feature, do our commits, do whatever it is we need to do, and we merge it back into develop when we're done. Relatively straightforward, and probably most of us, when we found that Git did branching, that's probably what most of us have done in the past. There are issues with this, and I will get into that. But for now, that's the way it goes. Then there is the release branch. So up here, we've worked on our feature, whatever, and now we're ready to issue a release of our code. So what we do is we establish a new release branch. You'll notice that the feature branch disappears after each feature is done. So we establish a new release branch. During the process of that release, this would be when we would test the code, make sure that it's ready for release. So you know, so there might be a couple commits along the release branch where some code changes and that sort of thing. And because of that, when we're done with the release branch, now that we're sure that this code is stable and ready for deployment, ready for giving to consumers, putting on the production machine, you know, whatever, what have you, we take the changes that were made here, if there were any, and it splits. So the master branch gets everything that was ready for release, gets over here, gets tagged with a release tag. And because we might have made some changes, those changes need to be merged back into develop so that develop can keep in sync with everything that has happened. So it splits in both ways. Now master is established with, it has some code. Anybody who goes and checks out the master branch, we're very confident that this is good code. This is very stable. It might be a little out of date, as you'll notice. We continue on the develop branch to continue to develop, but it's older and stable. But of course, there's always things that break. So when something breaks on master and we need to issue some sort of hotfix, we establish again a new branch. This time, instead of pulling from develop, we only pull from master because it's a problem that needs to be addressed now on this code, which is supposed to be kind of the code that's available for everybody. Pull it from there, make the fix, push it back to here with a new tag so we can keep the history in sync. Of course, we've made a change. That change needs to obviously go back here to our development branch, pops back over, and then the process just continues. So that right there, that's Git-Flow. That's the Git-Flow model. Very simple. You might even be doing it on your own. It's pretty intuitive. I imagine a lot of people have kind of picked up pretty much most of this on their own. But so when I told you before that Git-Flow was not software, I was kind of lying. So sorry, I kind of lied. It's a model, but because Git has the alias ability of aliasing new commands, doing some of these tools, as you'll notice, we make a branch, we merge the branch to two other branches, then we delete the branch. There's actually a lot of commands that would need to be done to do this by hand. You know, for each particular step along this path, there might be, you know, 2 to 3 to 4 different commands to do at once, which is, you know, that's doable, but it can get annoying. So there is a group of Git aliases for Git-Flow that you can get. This is the repository of where they're at. You don't need them to do the Git-Flow pattern because it's just a pattern, but it's awesome to have. They make your life a lot easier. It feels a lot just like using regular Git because it just extends the Git command listing to do a lot of these. It just takes care of the heavy lifting for you. So they're pretty nice. The other fun thing about this is because it's just Git underneath it all. There's nothing special about it. There's no extras. There's nothing like that. It's really easy to get going and to get started on using the Git-Flow process. Manually, you can just make these branches on your own. Or if you use Git-Flow, you can just use Git-Flow init. That'll either establish those branches on an existing repository, or if you're starting from scratch, just it'll go through the Git init and all that and get everything set up for you as well. So if you're interested in kind of getting started, seeing how it works, pretty easy to get going. Is there a question?
And they're all implemented as aliases.
I'm pretty sure, yeah.
Yeah,
So all the ones I've used. So there's quite a few. So here's some examples. And so I'm going to fake a terminal because I didn't want to, you know, I wanted to make sure it would work because it never works. Not for me, at least. So we're going to start off. Can everyone read that? Is that too small of a font? Okay. Because I can't fix it. It's too late. But all right. So we'll make a project. Like, it's totally fake. So yeah, sorry. We'll go into our project and Git-Flow init. And this will start our project. And when we do, it goes through, initializes an empty Git repository. Like I said, underneath it, it's just regular Git. No branches exist yet. Base branch must be created now. Wow, I've just messed that up. Like I said, it always goes weird. Oh well. Oh, come on. So a few things while that's loading, if it loads, which would really suck if it doesn't. A couple things to note. This little script that will establish the branches, it's going to ask for the names of the branches. While Git does have a configuration file, it's not doing anything special to your Git repository. What that means is that if anyone else downloads your repository and they're using Git-Flow, so another coworker, a third party who's going to make use of your code, they're going to have to know the names of your branches. Because if they don't, they can establish their own own names of the branches that they would like to have. And if two different naming conventions exist, they can exist side by side completely. And that means that if someone's using a feature branch and they aren't naming the branches the same as you, their branches will exist side by side alongside yours. Using the Git-Flow alias commands, your machine is really only going to be aware of the stuff that adheres to its configuration files. And so, yay! What that means is you may not like the defaults, and you can change them if you want, but if you do, you need to make sure that you tell everybody who's going to make use of your source code, you need to tell them what you're changing everything to, because they don't have to adhere to it, and if they don't, it could mess things up. That's another reason why, even if you don't like the master, the develop master convention, if it's a little backwards in your head for how things go, it's a good reason to maybe stick with it, just because if it's a standard, everyone else is going with the standard, you can at least say, yeah, we're using Git-Flow, and if you don't say anything else, they'll probably go with the defaults as well, and everything will be hunky-dory. So we'll go through, show that. So yeah, the branch name for the production release, master. So have the master branch. The next release, developments, what you're working on, develop. And how do you want to name your supporting branch prefixes? Because they all have this prefix to keep them separated. So we'll call feature, release, hotfix. Support, I'm not really going to cover too much. It's kind of experimental still. I will cover it a little bit later. But for now, just it exists. I'm not going to show it. And then you can put a prefix on the tags so that any tag that somebody names will automatically get this particular prefix in front of it. Again, you'll notice the default is nothing. So again, you'll have to tell other people what the prefix is if they're going to also make use of this automated functionality. So we'll just leave it how it is. Okay, so we have our repository here. You'll notice we're on the develop branch, which is like master before, where we develop. Git status, yeah, we're on develop. So let's commit something. So we'll start off and one thing I guess I should mention is the feature branches are great for developing features, but there are some things that don't really make sense to belong in the feature branch. And the development branch can commit and work on the develop branch if you want. It's not, it's a model. It's simple. It needs to be messed with, obviously. You don't have to follow it exactly. Some of the things that really fit with the develop branch would be configuration files, unit tests, anything that's really centralized to the project that isn't really feature dependent, really belongs on the development branch. So we'll make a README. And this is a README file for our project. We'll save that, and we'll add it there. We'll commit it. Okay, we have a commit on the develop branch. Now we'll start on our awesome new feature. So you'll notice Git-Flow has established the command flow, which then can follow with what we have. So we'll do Git-Flow feature start. Almost all the Git-Flow commands are based around this idea of starting and finishing a task. So in this case, we're going to start the task of a new feature branch. So we'll start our awesome new feature. Boom, we have an awesome new feature. And it actually tells us what we did. We created the feature branch, awesome new feature branch from develop. We moved over to that branch. That branch is now checked out. And we're ready to do stuff with it. So we'll make a new feature file. And we'll add it to that branch and commit it. And boom, there we go. We have a commit on the feature branch. That's all we need. You know, whatever. We just needed an empty file for some reason. So we'll finish this feature. So Git-Flow feature finish. And that will merge all the changes. It's a fast-forward merge. So it's going to take the history of that branch, and it's going to merge it into the history of develop. I don't show that in the little graphic up here, because to be honest, that would get a little, there'd be a lot of circles in a row. So there are a couple things to keep in mind with this. You will not lose the history of the branches, even though the branch, as you'll see, is now deleted. The branch never existed. It's gone. But the blame, if you want to do a git blame on all the files and find out who did what on each of the files, that will still work, because we're going to be merging all the commit history into the develop history. But you are going to lose the kind of that concurrent history. You aren't going to really be able to follow it in order, because you could have multiple feature sets being working on at the same time, merged at different points. So the actual from point A to point B history, it might be a little confusing, might be a little weird.
Can you disable fast forward in Git-Flow, like by default, for example, if you don't like fast forwarding?
I believe you can. I haven't actually done that, but yeah, I'm pretty sure you can. And again, even though these are just aliased commands, you can extend your own. You can override them. You can just delete the branch, merge it manually, and all that sort of stuff. Git-Flow really just keeps track of it by the basis of those prefixes. So if a feature branch doesn't exist, it's not going to think that it still exists. It just looks basically using git status. So yeah. We merged it back. We're back on develop, and that's all we needed. So we're ready to release. I have no idea why we would need a project with an empty file, but whatever. So again, we will now do a Git-Flow release start. Start and finish is what it is. And in this case, we're going to give it the name of what the release tag's going to be. So 1.0. So we go to release. Here's where we are. We're now in the release branch. We're going to do anything that we need to finish it up, make sure it's all working. But you know what? It's pretty good. So we'll just finish it. In this case, I wanted to say remember the quotes, just because periods can sometimes cause weird things to happen. So there's going to be two things that we need to do. We're going to be merging back to develop. And that's all that this is. This is just a history tag to keep track of the merge. That looks fine to me. And then we're going to write a tag message. This is basically going to be associated with the master branch and the tag we're going to create. So make sure you put something in here that's, that makes sense, that people can look back on as part of the history. Yeah, this is release 1.0.
So basically, that's just like change.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, just the commit messages basically. But in this case, on establishing that tag, we want to give a message for the tag, and we've now split it across. Develop has been pulled from release, and master has been pulled from release, and release is gone. Never existed. It's gone.
So obviously, if you were doing this manually, that's several different steps that you have to take, right?
Right.
Mm-hmm. The last steps. But that also makes me worry a little bit. How atomic are the aliases that Git-Flow is doing? If somebody trips over my tower core in between the steps, am I going to be left in a state of state? I have something merged over to master but not merged back into develop, but I could accident, if I don't notice that accident, is it a major or step?
I'll be honest, I'm not entirely sure on that. One thing I don't actually cover here is pushing to the remote server. So obviously everything that I'm doing on here is just on my local machine. The develop branch and the master branch, they are with a push that they're pushed back. There is the command git-flow publish, which will basically identify that this branch also needs to be pushed to the remotes upon a push. So if you needed to have that all happen on the remote as well without just pushing the changes across, you could publish the different pieces, I suppose, and do it that way. But it really works more around the idea of doing all these things locally and then pushing the changes all the way across. As for how atomic they are, I gotta imagine it's probably just some pretty simple shell scripts. It's probably just doing them one after the other concurrently. So, no, it's an awesome question. I'm sorry. I wish I could speak more to that. No, it's okay. Okay, so we've pushed to master. Now we're on master. This is just in case there's anything you need to do to finish things up on the master branch. Any last minute changes to make, but. Not really anything that needs to be done. So we'll go back to develop. We're ready to keep on going. We'll start another feature. And so we're on the other feature now. And oh no, something blew up. Something horrible happens, because that always happens. Well, now we need to fix that. So even though we're over on the feature branch right now, instead of stashing or anything like that, we'll just take advantage of Git's awesome branching abilities. And we will do a hotfix start. Now, hotfix really only applies to master code. So we're pulling from master to the new hotfix branch, and we're going to fix the problems that were on master. And in this case, well, I made an empty file, and that doesn't actually do anything. So we'll go in here. We'll put something into the file. And okay, so now the file is full. We will we'll commit it to the hotfix branch. That fixes our problem, I suppose. And we'll finish. We'll give it a new tag because we want to keep the history of everything up to date. So I'm actually going to bump the version number up. You can name the tags whatever you want. You don't have to be limited in terms of doing version numbers or anything like that. But technically, this is going to occupy a new space on master, so I'm going to give it a new tag. We have the merge commit option there. Tag message, let's fix a small error. And boom, back to master, back to develop. Well, because we're done with the hotfix, hopefully that's we're crossing our fingers, that's all we needed to do. We're not going to go back to master. Instead, we're going to go back to develop. It doesn't keep track of where you were. So instead, I'll have to, so I'm on branch develop. These are the branches that are currently in existence. So I actually want to go back to my feature branch. So we'll switch back there, and we'll work on making another file. It's also empty, so that'll cause problems in the future too. But we'll just keep on going. And that's the basic layout and functionality of doing Git flow. No, it's okay.
Uncommitted on developer or in feature. Because if I'm switching directly back to hotfixes.
Yeah, that's true. You will need to stash those, yeah. But yeah, it's just checking out from branch to branch.
Okay.
Yeah. That's true. I should have. Yeah. Sorry, I should have thought of that.
No, I was just wondering if Git-Flow might be like you have to do that
something. No. Okay, so here, that's where most of the presentations that you'll find online pretty much go, is just kind of into, here's our example, here's how awesome it is, that sort of thing. I do want to talk about, there are some real world issues that you will need to deal with, because it's not as simple as it seems. These are the four main ones that I can think of, is continuous integration, the problems with merging, actually figuring out what a hotfix is, and dealing with the issues of who's actually using your master branch. So there's... some people may be aware that there's kind of an ideological battle going on right now in terms of development styles and development strategies. And this is the battle between feature branching and continuous integration. And I don't actually see an end in sight. I don't actually know, unless someone thinks of some really awesome and cool way of solving these two approaches to development, it's going to always be a problem. So with continuous integration, that's basically the idea of doing continuous testing, continuous analysis of the code to prevent bugs, to have something to show your consumers that the development is proceeding. Feature branching is the idea that developers, when they're developing, will have kind of a pristine, sectioned off portion of the code that nobody else other than who's working on that feature branch is going to be able to touch. It's really nice. Continuous integration, it's really nice for project managers. They like that kind of stuff. Feature branching is really nice for developers. We like not having that, not having to have other people step on our stuff. The problem is, where does the testing occur? Do we want to have testing always being occurring with every change that occurs on a feature branch? That gets really annoying for developers after a while. But if you have the feature branch live for too long away from kind of whatever, because most people are going to be kind of applying continuous integration to the development branch, if the feature branches exist too long away from the development branch, you really lose the points of continuous integration because developers are developing on code that's not being tested. And if that lives on there for a day, for 2 days, for a week, for 3 weeks, they're developing code that has nothing to do with the testing strategies that you're trying to apply. So these are questions that you'll need to answer personally on a team basis, possibly even on a project basis, which is Git-Flow is a feature branching solution. It basically chooses a side. It supports feature branching. That's really what it's focused on. So you'll have to decide how big does a feature get before it's better to split it into smaller features so that the code that people are working on doesn't live too long outside of testable code. And yet, how long will it be allowed to live? There's no answer. It doesn't go that far on answering. And as continuous integration becomes more and more popular, because it really is kind of becoming really a very, I don't want to say a default way of doing things, but a lot of people are adopting it as kind of a way to keep track of things in an agile fashion. It's going to become a bigger issue. The other problem is merging. Git is really good at merging. It has a fantastic merging engine, but that merging engine is text-based. And I don't know about you, I haven't actually hit issues so much with merging code back in from branching, but I know the problems could exist that if I'm working on a feature branch and merge it back in, if I'm the first one to merge it back in, I'm happy because there's no problems. Who cares? Whatever. This guy sucks because who knows what's going to happen with his code. You know, if she's working on this branch over here and she merges back in, we can merge the code just great in terms of trying to resolve textual problems where one piece of code overrides pieces of another piece of code. But in terms of how it behaves, yeah, who knows? Whatever. That could be a problem. The only real solution is you need to make sure, again, getting back to testing, is that you have robust testing on the develop branch so that when you merge back into the develop, yeah. Oh, okay. Just when you merge back into develop, you need to make sure that you have something in place so that you have a reasonable assumption of stability. So if someone worked on one function and somebody else also worked on that function in two different feature branches and they merged back together, one could have changed the entire functionality of that. And even though there's no technical problems in terms of the way that the merge occurred, now the behavior has been altered completely. And, you know, you could have all sorts of horrible crashes.
Well, in my workflow, what I usually use, you would just merge from development over to development of features. So that way you get rid of all those
No, it does. And again, since technically underneath it all, this is Git, you could establish that.
Yeah, I don't know what Git does.
No, it it pretty much just does a simple merge back. That's pretty much it.
So the solution I found for that is just from ingest testing.
Yep. So yeah, like I said there, just make sure you have testing in place to make sure that that you can get the code back together. And that's true. You could always manually merge from develop back to the feature branch before you merge back using Git-Flow. But I don't know. You'll have to adapt it to your own strategies. The other problem is, what's a hotfix? If it's something small, like a file didn't have anything in it, well, that's fine. That makes sense. That's cool. What if it's something even bigger? Well, if it's too big, if something is just really broken, you're probably just going to have to, whatever's using the master branch, you're just going to have to manually roll it back to an earlier tag. You're probably going to have to just go and establish some feature branches that deal with the problems, and you're going to have to just make a new release. There's no real way to, just by the nature of having the hotfix pull from master instead of from develop, develop could have gone way further down, but you don't get the benefit of any of those changes. This pulling from master here has pretty much only pulled way back in develop. So you don't get the benefit of any of the development stuff over here. So that's another problem. And the final problem is who's actually using your master branch. Git-Flow is really good for software as a service solutions. So those of you, like me, who work in web development, oh, this is great. Who cares? Because we know that whoever's using our system, they're using our production servers. And we're in charge of our production servers. So we can make sure that our production servers are always using whatever is on master. Now, if you're producing GUI code of some sort that is going to be run on a desktop or on a mobile phone or something like that, where it's outside of your control as to what version of the software someone's using, well, if someone's using 1.0.2 and they have a problem here, well, a hotfix is fine. But what if someone's using 1.0 and they have a problem? A hotfix is not going to pull from 1.0. It's in the past. It doesn't matter. It's gone. So the support, there is the support branch, which, like I said, is experimental. It tends to jump back and forth in the way that it behaves. There's really no good solution from Git-Flow on how to deal with a problem that exists in 1.0 that people might be using when you've already moved on past that in master. The support branch will basically branch off of the older 1.0, but then you have the problem of where do you store the how do the changes that you made in an older version, how do those get back to develop? Should they go back to develop? Development has probably gone on for a long time. You're probably okay without it. Maybe you aren't. So should you merge those changes back to develop when develop has already maybe gone on to 2.0, 3.0? What do you do with it? And so that's one of the other issues that is not answered. The support branch, like I said, it kind of bounces back and forth. One of those things that bounces back and forth is, in the past, I believe it did merge back into develop, but I believe right now it does not merge back into develop. It leaves the support branch open until you manually delete the branch, because it's pretty much up to you to figure out what to do with the changes you made in the support branch. So support branch does exist. That's one of the reasons that I didn't want to cover it, is just because it's kind of still up in the air in terms of the methodology. It doesn't apply as well towards having multiple versions in existence. But one of the cool things from a web point of view that I found really cool about Git-Flow and that we're trying to work is it works really well with automatic deployment. So you'll notice each of these branches really lines up really well with a particular server. The development environments, feature branches are developed over there. The staging server, which is where you can have your Jenkins Hudson server for doing your builds and that sort of thing, that can basically continuously be looking at the develop branch. If a change happens on the development branch, then it can, as long as it's looking at the Git repository, anytime a change occurs on that branch, it can initiate build tests. It can run the unit tests, it can run the Selenium tests, it can make sure everything's working in that way. And so having continuous integration applied toward the develop branch is actually pretty cool. You can get a lot done by that. If you have a QA server that stands, you know, to make sure that production code is working well, that's what release is for. You can have your QA server also looking to see, does a release branch exist? What is the most recent release branch? If you want it, it's not as straightforward. We're trying to kind of get it figured out where I'm at right now. But the hope would be that when we make a release branch, we can have the QA server basically looking at the repository. And when that branch is made, it automatically will pull down the new code and put it onto the QA server. And again, the same thing with the production servers. We want to get to a point where deploying to master could be potentially as simple as pushing the changes to master to our GitHub repository, having the production servers looking at GitHub, seeing that master has changed with the new tag, and pulling that tag down and having that basically deploy the new source code. So that's been one of the cool things that's really first drew me to Git-Flow is just the fact that it lines up really well, at least with a web development strategy. And the fact that it can, hopefully in the future, we might be able to get to a point where we could run deployment through Git, which is kind of an interesting aspect of doing things. We'd be able to keep a commit log, be able to keep a blame of who made these different branches and when and where, and it might be pretty cool. It might be crazy, because maybe we're giving too much authority to people, since we are controlling it all through the Git repository, but yeah, we'll see. So in conclusion, just to kind of finish up, it's not software. It's a model, it's a methodology, although that's kind of a lie, because there are the command line tools. It goes about 80% of the way. It's a simple solution for real world problems, and that means it's not actually going to solve everything. But it is probably going to make things a lot easier. The issues that it doesn't cover are issues you probably are going to hit anyways, so it kind of forces the issue. And it's easy to just get started. Kind of like if you used Git SVN when transitioning from SVN to Git, you know, that kind of made the transition easier. Using Git-Flow applies towards an existing Git repository. It's pretty easy to just get going and just get started. And if it doesn't work out for you, well, you can just kind of deal with the branches that it makes and kind of merge them back and get rid of it. It's not too hard to deal with. And above all, it helps resolve a lot of headaches that do pop up. But before the questions, I do want to point out, obviously, like it is Git underneath it all. So one of the great things about it is you can do all the regular Git stuff. So if you have multiple people working on a feature, you can set each person's development box to be a remote so that people can push the feature branches to and from each other without having to push to a centralized repository to keep each other in track. You can do all the great things that hopefully you're doing already with Git, since it's just Git underneath it all. But hope that helps. Are there any other questions? Well, if it works out for you, I hope you enjoy it. Thanks.